To the Hour of the Time, I'm Pooh.
And I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're back. I had an experience today that I would like to share with you, only I can't right at the moment. You see, I received the first six chapters on the book that we are publishing on the Oklahoma City bombing. The first six chapters cover the time from the initial explosion until 12 noon. That's how thorough our investigation has been. The book is devastating. Absolutely devastating. It's going to be a while before it's ready to be let out upon an unsuspecting public that is trusting its government to tell them the truth about the Murrah Federal Building. And the devastation wreaked upon it on April the 19th. And the days, weeks, and months following. Absolutely devastating. And that's all I'm going to say about it right now. It's in the editing stages. And as soon as the editing is completed and layout is done, which won't take long after editing, it will go to press. If you honestly believe that anyone has been telling you the truth about the Oklahoma City bombing, other than the Hour of the Time and Veritas, you'd better think again. I'm trying to put over to you some sense of expectation here, but I really can't do it without tipping over the milk bottle, if you know what I mean. And I certainly don't want to do that until the time comes for that to happen. I will tell you this. There were more than one explosion. I should say was more than one explosion. At least two, absolutely beyond any shadow of a doubt. Proven beyond any shadow of a doubt, possibly a lot more. Evidence indicates that there was most probably more than two. And I mean by more than two, several more than two. That the largest explosion that took place occurred inside the building. And I'm not going to say any more because I just really don't want to pour the milk out on the street yet. when this book gets into the hands of the public, it's going to be all over for those who have perpetrated this deception. And for anyone who might think seriously about trying to stop this from going to press, you better think twice about that also. And that's one of the reasons I'm making this announcement tonight, so that any attempt to stop it, the public will know exactly why and exactly who is doing it, because it only implicates one entity, and that is the United States government. Also, as we do with everything of any importance that might endanger any of the members of the intelligence service, or me or my family, we have already made many copies and distributed them into safe hands across the nation, and nothing and no one, no power on the face of this earth can stop the publishing of this book. You may have all the money in the world, you may have the greatest technology and the counsel of what you think are the greatest brains upon the face of this earth. But you see, you're coming from a place of pure evil, lies, deception, and manipulation. And we are coming from a place of pure truth. And in the long run, truth will always conquer the lie. Omnia Vincit Veritas is the motto of the intelligence service and of our newspaper Veritas. I would encourage all who are listening to this broadcast to understand one very important and deeply ingrained truth, and that is this: throughout the history of the world, man has struggled to maintain a position of individual liberty with responsibility, until this nation was founded and became a reality, and then the most powerful, most opportune, most gifted nation upon the face of this earth, man had always been owned by someone, some sultan, some emperor, some king, some emir, some sheikh, some plantation owner. Since the birth of this nation, since man had been granted the ultimate gift, a gift that he was originally endowed with before man created governments and nations, the trend is to take us back into that enslavement, that indebtedness, that indenturedness, that ruin. Throughout history, man has tried to live his life through the belief of the proponent by furthering or getting behind philosophies, flags, marching behind heroes. And I'm going to tell you now, if that continues, we will continue to march backwards into all of the bad that we have left. There's only one door that can save humanity at the present time. I said this years ago, and I say it again to you now. Information is the power of the 90s. Those who possess it can wield that power. Those who do not will be manipulated by that power. The door that I speak of, the only door that we have open to us that can preserve all of the good that man has brought about upon this earth and maintain the liberty of the individual, that door is called truth. We must open that door. We must walk through that door. We must seek the truth. We must live our lives by the truth. We must discard all deceptions, all lies, even those that we bring upon ourselves. For most of us lie, not to others each day, but to our own selves, to perpetuate that which we feel makes us comfortable. My wife and I are both suffering from colds, and so my nose is totally stuffed, and it is difficult to say what I really want to put across to you, but I am going to try nevertheless. Whatever new world we are marching into can only be good if it is built upon truth, if it is based upon a foundation of reality and truth. Not what someone preached to you from some pulpit, which, by the way, in the ancient languages, pulpit derives from the word phallic or phallus. And if you don't believe it, trace the root and you'll see. There is so much in our religious framework of all of the different organized religions today that is false, and it is leading us down the road on a path of lies. The people who represent us in Washington, D.C. are herding us into that same funnel, onto that same road that is paved with lies. They rationalize this to each other, that they are going to bring about a utopian world, a totalitarian socialist world government ruled by a council of wise men with a charismatic political and religious leader as the front man, and that there will be no more wars and no more muggings and no more deception and no more robberies. And I tell you that they are lying to themselves and they are lying to us, for what they are basing it on is deception, is lies, and is manipulation. If the world that they are attempting to bring about is a good world, why do not they stand up and tell the truth about what they are doing and enter into public debate? Why do they not come out honestly and tell us the truth about why we are in Bosnia, what our troops are really bringing into the world, that it is really to put more power into the hands of the United Nations, that it is one more chip in the sovereignty of the United States of America, which means ultimately the demise of the United States of America and the destruction of its Constitution. For in a world government, whatever document is the foundation of the world government will be the supreme law of the land. And if you have not read the United Nations Charter lately, or the resolutions that have been passed since its writing, then you had better do it. For I'm telling you now, there is not only no recognition, no protection of individual liberties, there is not even any recognition that such liberties exist in those documents. They talk about privileges. They talk about a world religion being okay to worship as long as it is legal, which means we go back to the old marriage of the church and the state. which our forefathers did so much to get away from, for they understood the persecution that follows such creation of such organizations. Everyone in this world must begin to seek and live the truth, whatever the truth may be, no matter who it hurts or helps. If it shatters your religious beliefs, then so be it. If it shatters all that you have been taught since you have been born, so be it. We can no longer say my country right or wrong. If it is wrong, it is wrong, and we must oppose it. We cannot oppose the action by President Clinton of sending our troops to Bosnia, and then once it is a fait accompli, turn around and say, we must support our boys. For the two are inseparable. If you support the troops, you support the mission, and they know that, and that is why they ask for your support in those terms. Americans have been so foolish for so many years. And if you really want to know how we arrived at the point in time and in the mountain of troubles that we stand upon today, get up out of your chair right this moment, march yourself into your bathroom, and look into the mirror. The problem will be staring you in the face. The answer will be looking back at you. We are not being destroyed from without, ladies and gentlemen. The destruction is being promulgated, created, implemented, put into action. The treason comes from within. All of you who call yourselves Republicans and then worship Newt Gingrich are fools. And you can write me all the nasty letters you wish if you studied the history of the man and the words that he speaks and look at the legislation that he has voted for. You will find that he is no Republican. He is not a conservative. He is a New Age, extreme left-wing liberal Marxist fanatic. If you pause long enough to study the actions of Bob Dole, you will see that he has promised you one thing and delivered exactly the opposite over and over and over again, including NAFTA and GATT. The truth is, as one famous man once said, there's not a dime's worth of difference between the Republican and the Democratic Party, and no matter which one is in power, we march steadily toward world government and a Marxist, socialist, economic system of cashless debt chained to a computer forever. Don't believe it? Open your eyes, for it is written everywhere. They speak the language daily. And you, in your apathy, your lethargy, your ignorance, and yes, your stupidity, cannot even see the nose on your own face. Oklahoma City, ladies and gentlemen, was America's Reichstag. On Monday, the anti-terrorist bill will be placed upon the floor for a vote. If you allow it to pass, ladies and gentlemen, it will be the end of the Bill of Rights. It will be the end of the constitutional protections of the rights of the individual. It will be the end of the United States of America. The anti-terrorism bill must be defeated, and you must begin calling tonight after this broadcast, and you must not stop until it is defeated. You must mobilize your neighbors, your organizations, your churches, the Boy Scouts, if you can. The anti-terrorism bill must be defeated, and it can only be defeated by you. You must begin calling at the end of this broadcast, and you must not stop. You must call, you must fax, you must write, you must demand, you must visit in person. You must not make the President of the United States a dictator. And that is exactly what this bill does. It goes to the floor of Congress on Monday. Bombing of the Murrah Federal Building in Oklahoma City. It was designed to pass the anti-terrorism bill. If you allow it to be passed, then you have condoned, you have endorsed the deaths of all of those people. We will now continue, ladies and gentlemen, with where we left off last night, in last night's broadcast. But I want to say one more time that I hope you listened carefully to the beginning of this broadcast up until this point, and I beg you to act upon it. And I also beg you to reassess the way that you are living your lives. Cast out all the lies. Begin an earnest search for the truth. And don't ever stop until you find it. It will be a lifelong search, believe me. Find that door in the distance with truth written upon it and begin to walk toward that door. And I hope to meet you there. And I hope that as a complete, a whole humanity, we can find the key to unlock that door, open it, and walk through it into a bright and wonderful future full of liberty, with responsibility for all men and all women, regardless of race, religion, our place of ancestral origin. And now back to man-made UFOs, 1944 to 1994, 50 years of suppression by Renato Vesco and David Hatcher Childress. What was being suggested then is that throughout the course of the Second World War, the Germans were sending ships and planes to the Antarctic with equipment for massive underground complexes. That at the end of the war, the Flying Saucer Project's team of scientists were taken from Germany by submarines U-530 and U-77. That the Americans interrogated the crews of those submarines when they docked in what they had thought was a friendly Argentina. That the Americans then, upon hearing of the Antarctic base, organized a military task force disguised as an exploratory expedition. That expedition was subsequently put to disarray when it came up against the extraordinary German saucers, and that the United States then pulled out of the Antarctic temporarily in order to build their own saucers based upon the designs found in Germany after the war. When they talk about vast underground complexes, this is no fantasy, ladies and gentlemen. For when our troops marched into Germany, they found underground complexes that were so vast, carved and blown out of solid rock, that some of the vast expanses of underground manufacturing and assembly plants were a mile in length and width. This is on record. This is no joke. Germany was literally sitting on top of a vast underground network of caverns and bunkers and manufacturing facilities and assembly lines and scientific laboratories. And I have in my possession some photographs and diagrams of what was an underground airbase and the entire airfield, except for just a small portion of the end, was underground. The planes took off underground and landed into the mouth of a cavern underground. And when it was all closed up from a distance, you couldn't even tell that anything was there. And this is probably where other governments since World War II decided upon building underground installations. There are networks of these types of installations, and we have proof of that all across the United States. What are they doing down there? No one really knows. Only some of the details of what these installations were built are known. We know that there are over 75 which were designated as places for the president to be taken in case of atomic war, some of them so far away from Washington, D.C., that we know that it could not possibly have been used to take the president to because he didn't have enough time from the first warning of an atomic attack to even get anywhere near those installations. So because we know that, we know that they were designated as sites for the president to cover for something else. We have found another 25 that we know were built by the Atomic Energy Commission in various western states, underground vast facilities. We know that there is an underground facility known as Mount Weather in Virginia, where an entire government in waiting exists, including president, vice president, cabinet, and head of agencies. I should say heads of agencies. It is a vast underground complex that includes a reservoir of drinking water. It also contains a database. This database, according to congressional testimony, contains at least 150,000 names of Americans who have been targeted for arrest. This, ladies and gentlemen, is in the congressional record. This facility was built under the plans for the continuity of government under the Eisenhower administration. this program supposedly has been disbanded. Yet the facilities still exist. The government in waiting is still there. The guards at the gates still check identification of anyone who approaches. And on the fences, there are signs authorizing the use of deadly force to stop trespassers from penetrating into the area. The second article was also of modest interest. It was, in point of fact, a rather crude propaganda statement masquerading as a scientific review of Antarctic potential, dusting off the already well-known topographical facts. What one was left with was an insistence that the Democratic Republic of Germany should claim back their rights to that part of the Antarctic which the Nazis stole from the Norwegians and arrogantly renamed Neuschwabenland. Taking note of the National Socialist leanings of the article, bearing in mind the fact that Brissot was a one-shot publication whose origins were untraceable, and reminding myself that the whole theory had suspicious parallels with the more far-fetched holes in the poles UFO myths, I nevertheless checked up on other aspects of the article and discovered that the Germans had, in fact, been patrolling the Antarctic regions of the South Atlantic Ocean throughout the war. And ladies and gentlemen, there are no holes at the poles. I know several pilots who have flown over both poles in aircraft. There are no holes at the poles. Very soon there will be civilian charted aircraft flights that you can ride on that will take people who want an extraordinary adventure on a flight over whichever pole you wish. And then for the first time, the public will be able to see for themselves. And he says, I nevertheless checked up on other aspects of the article and discovered that the Germans had, in fact, been patrolling the Antarctic regions of the South Atlantic Ocean throughout the war. Indeed, 2 years after the Richter expedition, a couple of large Norwegian whaling ships were seized by boarding parties from the German raider Penguin as they rested at anchor in their own territorial waters just off Queen Maud Land. Within hours of that incident, a Norwegian supply ship and most of the nearby whaling convoy had been lured into the German trap, and the war in the Antarctic was underway. In May 1941, HMS, or Her Majesty's ship, Cornwall, located and sank the Penguin, but not before Penguin had captured a whole string of Allied merchant ships totaling more than 135,000 tons. What is also historical fact is that Penguin's sister ships, appropriately named Comet and Atlantis, continued to prowl the Antarctic shores until the end of the war. Regarding the two submarines, I also came across some startling information. U-977, under the command of Captain Heinz Schaefer, did in fact leave Kiel Harbor in the Baltic Sea in April 1945, stopped in at Christiansund, South on April 26th, left Christiansund South the following day, and was not seen again until it surfaced at Mar del Plata, Argentina, on August 17th, 1945, a period of nearly 4 months. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I served in submarines aboard the USS Tyru SS-416, which was a World War II diesel-electric Guppy 3A. And I can assure you that a period of 4 months for that type of submarine at that time in history was an extraordinary feat between ports of replenishment. Because of the time that it occurred, most of that 4 months had to have been spent underwater, which again, for that period of time, for a submarine crew, was an extraordinary feat. Where was the submarine all that time? According to Captain Heinz Schaefer, they had left with the intention of patrolling the South Atlantic, had docked for fuel at Christian turned south the following day, and had then several days later heard over their radio the news that the war was over. Convinced that he would not be treated too kindly by the Allied command, Schaefer gave his crew the option of being put off along the coast of Norway or traveling on with him to what he thought was a friendly Argentina. Since some of the crew preferred to return to Germany, the next few days were spent in hugging the Norwegian coastline until on May 10th they dropped some of their men off on the mountain coast, not far from Bergen. This done, according to Schaefer, he and the remaining crew embarked upon what surely must have been one of the most remarkable feats of the war, a total of 66 days underwater in a diesel-electric World War II submarine. Any submariner who has served on modern submarines will tell you that that was an extraordinary feat beyond any concept of the capabilities of not only the submarines of that day, but of the men who manned those vessels in that day. A total of 66 days underwater, through the North Sea and the English Channel, past Gibraltar and along the coast of Africa, and finally surfacing all of 66 days later in the middle of the South Atlantic Ocean. During the next month, they alternated between floating on the surface and diving back to the depths, once even surfacing off the Cape Verde Islands and going ashore on Branca Island, another time going so far as to disguise the submarine when it was on the surface by rigging up false sails and funnel to make it look like a cargo steamer. Finally, when close to Rio de Janeiro, they heard over their radio that another fleeing German submarine, U-530, had put into the River Platte and that its crew had been handed over to the United States as prisoners of war. Disturbed by this, they nevertheless put into Mar del Plata on August 17, 1945, nearly 4 months after they had put out from Kiel Harbor. Now, this rather fantastic story was recounted by Captain Schaefer to the Argentine authorities when they interrogated him on three specific issues. One, where had U-977 been when the Brazilian steamer Babia had been sunk? Two, how come U-977 had arrived in Argentina so long after the war had finished? And three, had U-977 carried anyone of political importance during its voyage to the Argentine? Schaefer denied that he had been anywhere in the area of the Babia when it was sunk, explained his late arrival in Argentina with the fantastic story that I have just recounted, and stated that no one of political importance had ever been aboard U-977. Now, what is really intriguing about all this, ladies and gentlemen, is that a few weeks later, an Anglo-American commission, composed of high-ranking officers, especially flown to the Argentine to investigate the mysterious case of U-977, spent a great deal of time interrogating Schaefer regarding the possibility that he might actually have taken Hitler and Martin Bormann aboard his U-boat, first to Patagonia and then to a secret Nazi base in the Antarctic. Indeed, they were so insistent on this that they subsequently flew Schaefer and his crew and Otto Wehrmuth, commander of U-530, back to a prisoner of war camp near Washington, D.C., where for months they continued their interrogations. While I could find no record of the fate of Commander Wehrmuth, what I did authenticate is that Schaefer repeatedly denied having shipped anyone anywhere. Nevertheless, he was handed over to the British in Antwerp and again interrogated by the British for many more months. Assuming that Schaefer was telling the truth and that the Allies found nothing unusual in Schaefer's U-boat, it seems rather strange that the Americans would later send the submarine back to the United States, where under direct orders from the U.S. War Department, it was blown to pieces with torpedoes. As for Schaefer, he was eventually returned to Germany, did not feel comfortable as one of the conquered, and then went back to join some fellow Germans in the Argentine. The possibility remains, ladies and gentlemen, that Schaefer might have been lying. For a start, it is decidedly odd that two insignificant German U-boats should have stirred such monumental interest among the Allies. It is also worth considering why the Allies would even have imagined that Hitler and Martin Bormann, or anyone else for that matter, would have fled to such an unlikely place as the Antarctic. Finally, it is worth noting that Schaefer had spent much of his career protecting the research centers at Riggan and Peenemünde, that he was highly experienced at patrolling the South Atlantic and the polar regions, and that he was one of a select group of naval officers who were sent to the Hartz Mountains to study the highly advanced 21 submarines. Schaefer was, in other words, a man with an extremely high security clearance, familiar with the secret underground establishments of the Hartz Mountains, and a man familiar with the Antarctic sea routes. Now let us review the situation, and we'll do that, ladies and gentlemen, right after this pause.
Watching till the morning comes creeping. Green door, what's that secret you're keeping? There's an old piano and they play it hot behind the green door. Don't know what they're doing, but they laugh a lot behind the green door. Wish they let me in so I could find out what's behind the green door. Not once, try to tell them I've been there. Door slam, hospitality's been there. Wonder just what's going on in there. Saw an eyeball peeping through a smoky cloud behind the green door. When I said don't send me, someone laughed out loud behind the green door. All I wanted to do is join the happy crowd behind the green door.
It is not confirmed, ladies and gentlemen, but it is very possible that the German Fireball existed, that it accounted for the first modern UFO sightings during the Second World War, and that an extraordinary flying machine, the Kugelblitz, was successfully test-flown in Germany a few weeks before the war ended. The Fireball, therefore, could have been the forerunner of the small, seemingly remote-controlled UFOs observed frequently throughout the final months of the war, while the Kugelblitz could have been the first of the larger pilot-controlled flying saucers. The unsigned flying saucer designs reproduced in Brissant and in a great many more Orthodox journals mentioned materials not in existence, as far as we know, during the war years. This suggests that they could have been reproductions of the original plans, which Flugkapitän Rudolf Schreiber updated just before his death in the late 1950s. Assuming then that Schreiber's mislaid or stolen notes and designs were actually in the hands of the SS. It is possible that they were secretly developed in one of the many underground complexes in the area of the aborted last redoubt, either the Nordhausen complex in the Hartz Mountains or at Kala in nearby Thuringia. That the completed saucer was test flown in the early months of 1945, and that it was then destroyed in the face of the Allied advance. We know from reproductions of the drawings of Schreiber, Belanzo, and Meith that a flying saucer project, no matter how primitive at the time, was definitely on the list of German military priorities. Regarding the fact that the only evidence of such machines is the evidence mentioned above, it should be borne in mind that the most fanatical of the Nazi SS were controlling the research centers in the areas mentioned, that as they retreated, they attempted to destroy as much as possible of their most important scientific papers and inventions, and that thousands of slave workers and their SS overlords, who could have revealed a great deal more, disappeared in the chaos of the liberation and were never seen again. Could some of them have gone to the Antarctic? Contrary to the accepted view, it is actually quite possible that the Nazis continually shipped and flew vital new men, material, and documents to the Antarctic throughout the war years. Regarding the possibility of the submarines of that time being able to complete such a lengthy journey, it is to be noted that the normal U-boat could cover 7,000 miles on each operational cruise, that the Germans had submarine tankers spread across the South Atlantic Ocean, at least as far as south of South Africa, and that any one of those tankers, which had a displacement of 2,000 tons, could have supplied 10 U-boats with fuel and stores, thus tripling the time that these U-boats could stay at sea. Regarding the possibility of the Germans building self-sufficient underground research factories in the Antarctic, it has only to be pointed out that the underground research centers of Nazi Germany were gigantic feats of construction, containing wind tunnels, machine shops, assembly plants, launching pads, supply dumps, airfields, and accommodation for all who worked there, including adjoining camps for the slaves, and yet very few people ever saw them or even knew that they existed. Given all this, it is in my estimation quite possible that men and materials were shipped to the Antarctic throughout the war, that throughout these same years the Germans were engaged in building enormous underground complexes in New Schwabenland, similar to those scattered around the last redoubt, and that the American, Russian, and British cover-up regarding saucer sightings could be due to the reasons given in the novel Genesis. Skeptics would argue that the major histories of the Third Reich either ignore or pass off as ridiculous any stories about German secret weapons. But such an argument can be countered by reminding the reader that most of the secret weapons projects were highly secret, usually controlled by the dreaded SS, and were therefore beyond the reach of later historians. But recently, for those of you who are fans of the television series called Wings, you know that these German secret weapons were fact, not fiction. And that television series has revealed never-before-seen footage of some of these secret air weapons in construction, in testing, and in actual flight. A recent publication of James, which is the world's expert on aircraft, ships, and military weapons of all sorts, published a book called German Jet Genesis, in which, ladies and gentlemen, James verifies the development of Germany's flying disc-shaped craft. While Albert Speer, as Minister of Armaments and War Production, was openly skeptical about the secret weapons in his otherwise eloquent book Inside the Third Reich, Weidenfield and Nicholson, London, 1970, he does admit that there was increasing speculation about such weapons during the closing months of the war, and that while he himself had stated at the time that there were not enough basic materials for the production of such, he had, in his own words, underestimated the large stocks of material that had been accumulated in the factories. Speer was equally skeptical when Robert Ley, the Minister for Labor, excitedly told him in April 1945 that his German scientists had invented a death ray, possibly a laser weapon. This is interesting when one considers the fact that Heinz Schäfer, captain of the submarine U-977, stated in his book U-Boat 977, William Kimber, London, 1952, that in April 1945, an SS associate had offered him a demonstration of a so-called death ray. It is unfortunate that Schaefer, in a hurry to return to Kiel for his famous last voyage, had no time to remain in Berlin and check out the validity of his friend's claim. For the purposes of fiction, I have utilized the real-life personages SS Generals Hans Kammler and Arthur Nibby. Readers might therefore be interested to know that while Nibby was placed on the Nazi death list after the attempted assassination of Hitler, his death was never actually confirmed, and many felt that he had simply fled for his life. As for General Hans Kammler, his history with the SS and the V-1 and V-2 rockets is well documented. But what became of him after he disappeared from Germany in April 1945 remains a mystery to this day. Regarding the members of the German flying saucer team, Shriver and Belanzo are now dead. Habermal was reported to have been captured by the Russians, thus the American military sphere of Russian saucers shortly after the war. And perhaps most interesting, Mythe, who stated to the press that he had worked on Project Saucer, went to work for the Americans and Canadians. Finally, for the record, the prototype for the Avro flying saucer, which was handed over to the United States and loudly proclaimed to have been a failure, is now in the United States Air Force Museum in Fort Eustis, Virginia. While the novel Genesis is a work of fiction, the fiction, ladies and gentlemen, is based on various facts, and those facts could do with further examination. And there is an extensive list of sources here, which are about 5 pages long. Now, what I have just read to you is only the introduction of man-made UFOs 1944 to 1994, 50 Years of Suppression by Renato Vesco and David Hatcher Childress. This book is approximately 420 pages in length, and the information, the documentation, the diagrams, the illustrations contained in this book are staggering, impressive. They are mind-expanding, to say the least. Intercept, but don't shoot. Ever since the United States Air Force top brass issued this order in 1948, American pilots have been mockingly defied by the unidentified flying objects that frequently invade the airspace of the United States as though on peaceful missions of exploration. Why hasn't the Air Force authorized its pilots to shoot these mysterious invaders down? Fear of extraterrestrial reprisal? I don't think so. Diplomatic protests from the unknown power that possesses the biggest secret of our times? I don't think so. Technological awe dictated by ignorance? Again, I do not think so. Or finally, deliberate deceit dictated by circumstances? And I believe that that is the proper and final answer. I believe that when the United States Air Force issues a statement that they are not studying unidentified flying objects, they are telling the truth. I believe that when the United States Air Force issues a statement that unidentified flying objects do not represent a threat to the national security, they are telling the truth. And all the ufologists across the world claim, cover up, cover up. They're telling the truth. And they're not covering up anything, they're just not telling you that the technology belongs to us. At some future date, it will be used to promulgate the illusion of an extraterrestrial threat, at which time the nations of the world will be made to get down on their knees and beg for the coming together under a one-world government for who speaks for planet Earth? Does anybody have an answer to that question? And in the face of such an external threat, Would not all humanity realize that we are all the same? And would it not be in all of our interest to come together as one in order to face that threat? Now, lest you think I have gone batty, ladies and gentlemen, I have just quoted to you the exact words verbatim of Ronald Reagan during his presidency as he stood upon a stage with Mikhail Gorbachev, pledging that the military might of the Soviet Union and the United States of America would come together at some future date in the face of an extraterrestrial invasion to repel them from the earth. Good night. And God bless you all. The hour of the time, ladies and gentlemen, is brought to you by Swiss America Trading, 1-800-289-2646. Call Frank. Tell him that you want to get your hands on some real money. Mention the fact that you are a steady listener to the hour of the time with William Cooper, and you will receive red carpet treatment. I guarantee it. Ask them for the current newsletter. For those of you that would like to purchase Man-Made UFOs 1944 to 1994, 420 pages of the most astounding documentation of the fact that UFOs are nothing more than a hidden technology belonging to the human race of several different governments. Send $25 postpaid. Please send us a physical address so that we can ship this by UPS and make sure that it gets directly to your door. Make check or money order payable to Annie, A-N-N-I-E. And send your payment to the Intelligence Service, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. The address will be repeated at the end of this broadcast.